Psalm 26, let's pray. Lord, as we jump into the text tonight, we ask that you would give us minds that are ready to receive what you have for us. We have come into the room here with all kinds of accumulated anxieties and distractions and discouragements, perhaps some accumulated joy and rejoicing and victory. But the last several days, Lord, of the week have been days without fellowship and days out there in the world, working our jobs and going through life, putting our discipleship into practice, allowing our Christianity to be tested and our faith to be refined. So I can only imagine what each one of us is feeling as we come to the table tonight, but we pray that by your Holy Spirit we would receive the grace and the mercy that only you can give and be encouraged through your word and perhaps challenged. Give us insight, nourish our souls, and prepare us for the days ahead, Lord. Only you know what they hold. We pray for your guidance, and we pray for your spirit. Amen. Psalm 26, God helps those who pray for themselves. You've heard the saying, God helps those who help themselves. I don't know that that's true. But if we change the phraseology just a bit, it suddenly becomes radically true. God helps those who pray for themselves. Now, I'll tell you that I run into people from time to time that pride themselves on not praying for themselves, as if that's some sort of great act of humility and selflessness to always include others in your prayers, but never turn the focus inward, never lift yourself up in prayer, never address your needs or desires before God. But I'll tell you and remind you, if you're a student of Scripture, that that's really not the way that it looks in the Bible. There are throughout Scripture, Old Testament, New Testament, a lot of notable figures in Scripture prayed for themselves. We see Solomon praying for himself, and it ended up being a pretty decent prayer. I mean, if it hadn't been prayed, I don't know that it would have been answered. If it hadn't been answered, we wouldn't have Proverbs, and we would be missing perhaps Ecclesiastes and Song of Solomon to boot, because what Solomon prayed for on his own behalf was wisdom. I'm glad he prayed that. And I'm sure you are too. Gideon prayed for himself. Nehemiah prayed for himself. Jacob, Jonah, Moses. A popular one among charismatics or those of the prosperity theology persuasion is the prayer of Jabez. I don't know if I just figured you'd be familiar with that. But for the rest of us who are totally unaware of who this character Jabez is, he was a man who in 1 Chronicles chapter 4 prayed for prosperity. He unflinchingly prayed that God would make his life great. Give me riches and kids and whatever else I want. Some camps have snagged that and turned it into something entirely different than what the truth of God reveals. But at any rate, he prayed for himself. We see in the New Testament the Apostle Paul prayed for himself, and in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, and this is a familiar passage for some of us, this is the part where Paul prayed three times that God would remove the thorn from his flesh, whatever that may be, whether it's a spiritual malady or a physical infirmity or just a mental sort of struggle. He had a problem and he prayed for relief, prayed for himself. Jesus prayed for himself, for crying out loud. I mean, those that take the position of, you know, it's kind of somehow unholy to pray for yourself or super humble to not. What do we do with John chapter 17 then? There you have Jesus in the first five verses praying for himself. If he's doing it, I dare say that it's okay. It's okay to pray for yourself. Not only is it okay, but if Jesus did it, then it's exemplary. The reason I bring this whole thing up is because Psalm 26, it's pretty clear when we read through it that David here is praying for himself. He uses the terms I, me, or my 27 times in 12 short verses. Okay? It's apparent that he's praying for himself. 27 if I counted right. Now, I don't want you to take the time and get so distracted that you start counting those pronouns. Take my word for it. It's 27. If I'm wrong, God will forgive me. But he's praying for himself a lot here. And that's the big idea. If we have examples in Scripture, David, Moses, Jacob, yes, Jabez too, and Jesus himself praying for themselves, then we need to know that it's okay for you to be praying for yourself. Now, if you still have a hard time with this idea, now listen, there's some people in here, they have no problem praying for themselves. If anything, they're neglecting the idea of praying for anybody else. Now, I don't know how I'd weigh in on that at this point. You know, prayer is meant to be something that we can bring our needs to God, but we should also be interceding for the needs and weaknesses and things of others. So we see that in these examples also. To refrain from praying for yourself because you think it's selfish would be kind of like not eating for the same reason, only worse. Okay? You should eat. It's okay. It's not a self-centered action there. And neither is praying. If you're going to pick one or the other, I would suggest maybe praying. You're going, what, pray and not eat? Well, other ones have done it, prayed and fasted. Don't underestimate the importance of praying for yourself. God has honored many self-focused prayers, both in Scripture and in otherwise, perhaps in your life as well. And God continues to do the same thing today. He honors those who pray for themselves. Prayer is helpful and you need help. And so no one knows your needs like you other than God. And so it's okay to pray for yourself. I feel like I need to say that simply because the very first thing that caught my attention as I sat down to read Psalm 26 was the fact that David was talking a lot about himself. It seemed to be pretty self-directed, this one. Not that it's uncommon for David. Go through the Psalms and you look and it's kind of a favorite theme. His problems, his needs, his troubles, his self. And Psalm 26 is no different. David's in trouble. We don't always know why he's in trouble, but we do know that he is in trouble, simply because of the way he phrases things in his psalms. In verse 1 of Psalm 26, he says, "Vindicate me, O Lord, for I have walked in my integrity. I also have trusted in the Lord. I shall not slip." Vindicate me, he says. Vindicate me. Vindication. Now this is an interesting idea, and it's not one that, again, not an idea that is unfamiliar to Scripture. We see it here and we see it elsewhere. We see it oftentimes, and it's a very thematic type of idea in Scripture. What vindication is it's something that is needed when a person finds himself the target of unfounded blame or suspicion. The reason vindication is so important for us and perhaps thematic in the Bible is simply because sooner or later as a Christian you'll need vindication. You'll find yourself the target of unfounded blame or suspicion. And vindication comes into play when, like in this case, the individual is unable to clear themselves of that blame on their own. They need assistance from a second party. In this case, it's God. And so David, obviously here, needing vindication, has become the target of suspicion or blame. And he makes his appeal to God for the clearing of his record, his integrity, and his reputation. And again, we don't know why David looks bad in the eyes of others. We don't know why he looks suspicious. He just does. Not because he's done anything particularly wrong or sinful. Okay? Probably on the contrary. Because he's been living a right life. And sometimes people in the world just don't like it when you're living a righteous life. You remember the Old Testament story in Genesis about Joseph? Remember that guy Joseph? The dude with the amazing jacket? like the guy, right? The guy with class. Remember him? He had fresh threads, right? Or whatever. I don't know. You know, he looked good. Anyway, this was a guy of great integrity, awesome reputation. I mean, this guy was stellar. And yet, he had a knack of kind of getting himself in trouble. He was doing right, but he kind of, I don't know, he just got himself into some situations. I mean, it started when he was a kid, you know? It's a bad sign when it's already happening, when you're just, you know, you're still in the house. He gets older, and he's growing up, and nothing changes. It's like the guy just keeps getting in trouble. He's not doing nothing wrong. I mean, there's the part where he's working as a hired hand, and I don't know, he's like the gardener or something. And then the guy that he works for, his wife, kind of takes a liking to Joseph. I don't know if he was working with a shirt off or what, but he caught her eye. She tried to seduce him. He wouldn't have it because he had integrity, and he, instead of remaining in the situation, just turned around and ran out the house. Unfortunate for him, she grabbed a hold of his jacket. I mean, you know, he was a well-dressed man. She grabbed a hold of his jacket, and he left, and so then she had evidence at her disposal to falsely accuse him of attempted rape, which she did. And then, of course, Joseph gets arrested and put into prison. And I mean, just like, what did the dude do other than, you know, fix the garden? He's being faithful at his job, right? When he was a kid, he was just being honest about his dreams. I mean, honesty and faithfulness, and all it gets you is like sold into slavery and imprisonment? That's so not cool. Joseph was a dude in great need of vindication. Like something, someone, somewhere, help me, vindicate me. I'm not guilty. Can something be done to just prove my innocence? And God's like, yeah, I'll put your whole story in the Bible so that everybody forever knows that you were innocent. Well, Joseph didn't know that at the time. And I'll tell you, David finds himself in similar situations from time to time. And again, I'll tell you that you, Christian, are going to find yourself in need of vindication from time to time. Because there's a sense in which all Christians who live their lives to honor God are going to think and behave so contrary to cultural, societal, worldly norms that they're going to be held in suspicion for it. The world's going to think you're weird. The world's going to not like your righteousness because it's so foreign to them, it bothers them. So it's inevitable for those who obey God to avoid the need sooner or later for vindication. Christians have been, are, and will be treated as evildoers and criminals, accused of intolerance, uncooperativeness, bigotry, bullying, discrimination, hatred, treason. The list goes on and on, simply because we go against the cultural tide. We refuse to drink the green American Kool-Aid. And so while our culture goes this way and we go that way, it bothers people, and so we're held in suspicion. We refuse to embrace homosexuality when the rest of the world is going, but it's okay. We refuse to allow ourselves to be indoctrinated with pagan principles when the rest of the world is paying tens of thousands of dollars for it. We refuse to clap our hands when the world dances, and we refuse to cry about the same things that upset the rest of mankind. We just covered this recently in Scripture. They indicted Jesus because, well, we played a cute little song for you and you didn't dance, and we sang a mournful song and you didn't cry. We expected you to do everything that we expect you to do. And so we're held in suspicion. We, along with Jesus, are called gluttons or drunkards or friends of sinners or anything that they can get their hands on. Anything to accuse you, anything. And you will find yourself in need one day, if not already, and you will again, of vindication. All Christians everywhere need to be vindicated because we refuse to go along with the world, and therefore we become suspect. The book of Revelation ultimately says that it'll come down to this, what, Mark of the Beast? You guys heard of that, right? And Christians ain't going to take it. So what's the world going to think of that? We're always the ones that throw the wrench into the gears of the world. They hate us for that. We're always putting a stick in the spokes. They're like, you're screwing up our fun. You guys, you always got to do your own way. Why can't you just be diverse, like all of us? Why can't you just be independent, but a sheep at the same time? Why can't you just do it like we do? If your life isn't if your life is marked by compromise rather than holiness, the world has no problem with you. Because you're playing by their rules. They accept you. And God doesn't. You're in no need of vindication. Why? Because you're jumping when they say jump. That's exactly what they want. And as long as you do what the world tells you to do, no one's going to hold you in suspicion, except for guess who? Genuine Christians. Well, David feels like he's in great need of vindication, and I'm telling you that all Christians are meant to feel that way as well. If we're not meant to feel the need for vindication, then why does it say in Psalm 135, verse 14, the Lord will vindicate his people? What does Moses write about it in Deuteronomy 32? The Lord will vindicate his people. The Lord will vindicate his people because the Lord's people will need vindication, because the Lord's people will obey God, and obeying God will cause suspicion in the eyes of the world. David says, I've been doing everything right, and yet I'm only incurring for myself suspicion in the eyes of the world. So he says, vindicate me, O Lord. I've walked in my integrity. I've trusted in the Lord. I shall not slip. Look at verse 2. He says, examine me, O Lord, and prove me. Try my mind and my heart. And so David invites God to show him if he's wrong. Because what if he is? David doesn't know. What David does know is that he's prone to thinking that he's innocent when he's not. So he wants to double check with God and go, God, listen, I look at myself and I don't think I've done anything wrong. I think I'm doing it right, but you better check me too, because I can't trust myself. You guys know that that's a healthy thing, to not trust yourself? You should have a healthy amount of distrust when it comes to you. Amen. Sometimes I think we're a little too trustworthy when it comes to ourselves, and David, he's not that way at all. He goes on from there in verse 3 and he says, for your loving kindness is before my eyes and I have walked in your truth. I'll read the next two verses shortly, but I want you to notice as I do that David is taking inventory of his own self before he asks God for help. Like in verse 3 he says, I have walked in your truth. That's his track record. That's past tense. He has a track record of walking in truth. And so David's taking an inventory of how he's been doing as a man of God, as an individual marked by faith. He's going, well, I've been walking in the truth. And consistently. And so listen, when you take inventory of your own life, you can't just go, well, I went to church once. You should be looking at what you've been doing, how what you've been, like your thought life, everything about you, what your pattern of life looks like. What does the last month look like? The last year? What does the last 5 years of your life look like? Are you walking in integrity? Do you walk according to the truth? Not last Sunday, but like, say, the last 52 Sundays and the last 312, 13 days in between. If I got my math right, don't check me. Just pay attention. Do you follow me? What does your track record look like? He says, your loving kindness is before my eyes and I have walked in your truth. He says, I have not sat with idolatrous mortals, nor will I go in with hypocrites. I have hated the assembly of evildoers and will not sit with the wicked. He's walked in integrity and in truth, he says. He says he's trusted God. He's taking inventory of his track record and going, well, I haven't been sitting with idolaters or the wicked. Okay? I don't visit with hypocrites. I don't spend my time in the assembly of evildoers. These are all synonyms for unbelievers. Perhaps even those who would consider themselves to be faithful when in fact they're not. And he says, I don't sit with them. Now I'll tell you this. It's a sad fact of life, but it's true. And it's not going to change until you're dead. But you don't have the luxury of deciding or controlling the kind of people that you come into contact with or that you're acquainted with, but you can choose who you'll sit with. And what I mean by that is you can't choose and you can't decide what the kind of people you work with are going to be, or you can't choose what your neighbors are going to believe or how they're going to live their lives, but you do get to decide who your friends are. And who you let into your life, who you sit with, so to speak. Who you keep company with is how the Bible would put it. See, in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, it says, you can't just separate yourself from everyone who's not a Christian, because to do that, you'd have to leave the planet. But rather, we should make a practice of not inviting too deeply into our lives those who think that they're Christian but clearly aren't. Therefore, according to 1 Corinthians 5, the Bible tells us not to have lunch. Don't even go so far as to eat dinner with these people and so prolong their self-deception. Rather, remove yourselves from the company that is so evil. It's doubly blind, thinking that it's okay with God when they're not. The Bible says also in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, 15, verse 33, it says, evil company corrupts good character. You can go back to Proverbs, written by the smartest guy ever, and he says, a companion of fools will also himself become a fool. And I don't think it means going to work with unbelievers. Listen, you can go to work with a whole team full of unbelievers and keep yourself, quote unquote, unspotted from the world. But when you decide to buddy up with somebody who's all lukewarm in their faith, and you think that you're just going to yoke yourself to them and everything's going to be fine, like they say they're a Christian so we can get married now, right? Wrong. Just because they're a Christian doesn't mean anything. Everybody's a Christian, right? Like what? Conservative estimates say that like 82% of Americans are Christian. Au contraire. Wake up. Like legit surveys who know what they're doing when they survey produce reports that say somewhere around 5% of Americans are Christian. So let's get off of this. They say they're a Christian, so it's okay. Okay, I'll give you the they say they're a Christian bit, but that's almost bad news. Because there's a huge, huge possibility that they're not. Once they say they are. 82% versus 5%. Be careful. Be careful. Listen, all this to say, be careful of who you're keeping company with. David is. David's going, I'm not only taking inventory of my own life, I'm taking inventory of everybody else because I want to be careful that I'm not letting into my life anybody that shouldn't be let in. So I might work with them. I might live next to them, but I don't sit with them. And you're like, I could never do that to somebody because I'm so, like, you know, Minnesota nice. Well, get Minnesota mean then. Quit playing Minnesota sin. And get some discernment already. It would be biblical of you. It would be holy. It would be godly. It would be Christian. Be careful how you interact with people in the unbelieving world. Here's something interesting. In the ancient world, at the time that this was written, your good character could only be corrupted through personal contact with another individual because that's all that there was. Today, 2016, we can be corrupted by another person's immorality through mixed media. Social, news, music, etc. We choose associations in our entertainment, and we often choose very poorly. We allow the wicked to amuse us, and then to become our examples, and then to become our models, and finally, our idols. C.S. Lewis once said this: many people have a very strong desire to meet celebrities, important people, including those whom they disapprove of. But I am inclined to think a Christian would be wise to avoid, where he decently can, any meeting with people who are bullies or lascivious, cruel, dishonest, spiteful, and so forth. Not because we are too good for them. In a sense, we're not good enough. We're not good enough to cope with all the temptations, or clever enough to cope with all the problems which a single evening spent in such company produces. See, I think on this issue we play flat, fast and loose, you know, and I'm not going to go so far and be so adamant about this that I'm going to outright condemn TV and movies and music and all that kind of stuff, because I'd be a hypocrite if I did. But I will tell you that I only, as I mature in Christ, become increasingly self-censoring in what I watch and what I listen to and what I pay money to entertain myself with. More and more and more, I decrease the amount of time I spend watching TV. You wanna find out how I feel about this? Ask my wife. You can watch as much as you want, but you have to understand what you're doing. You have to understand what you're opening yourself up to when you do it. You have to be a little bit discriminatory, yes, even when it comes to TV and movies. Some of you guys, you have such a low bar that it's gotta be affecting you. And this doesn't mean go home and throw your TVs away. This means pay attention to God and decide what you want out of life. Do you want to be entertained? Or do you want to be holy? Because sometimes you have to choose. The world, by dishing out whatever it is that it puts out there, is forcing you to choose. And by you not making a choice, have already made it. You've just opened up the doors, and whatever wants to be flooded into your mind, there is no stopping it. So be careful. David takes a very thorough self-inventory, and after he's done, he's found innocent. He's going, listen, I've trusted in you. I've held my integrity. I've not sat with corrupt individuals. And so it kind of validates his request for vindication, because vindication can only be requested when you're innocent. Like, you can't live an unrighteous life. Like, if you're living in sin, and then you're like, God, vindicate me. Everybody thinks I'm, like, in sin. Well, they have a right to think you're in sin, because you are. God ain't going to... Listen, vindication at that point is a moot subject, ain't it? God, vindicate me, because I've been living like an absolute hypocrite, and everybody thinks I'm a hypocrite. Help me. You know, my reputation. No, no. God's like, yeah, no vindication for you, right? I mean, like, so David takes an inventory. Apparently, he already had and found himself at least to his own ability to discern and found himself innocent. And so he feels the clearance then to plead with God for vindication. If you're living a lukewarm, sinful, foolish life, compromising your integrity, pursuing worldly things, giving all appearance of evil, making little or no attempt at all to walk in holiness, you're a spiritually unreliable liar. The world has every reason to hold you in suspicion, especially if you say you're a Christian. And we got too many Christians doing that, or so-called Christians anyway. Not David. And in verse 3, if I could read that one more time, he says, your loving kindness is before my eyes. I mean, he's observant of God. This is an intellectual affair. But he says, I have also walked in your truth. Walking means his actions, his thoughts and his actions. Like David has integrity inward and outward. Okay, he's not hypocritical, looking better on the outside, like everything on the inside, like he's not even a Christian, but he looks like one. No. Okay, nor is he a Christian on the inside, but on the outside, doesn't even try. No, what he claims to be on the inside is what people would see on the outside. Moving on in verse 6, he says, I will wash my hands in innocence. So I will go about your altar, O Lord, that I may proclaim with the voice of thanksgiving and tell of all your wondrous works. Lord, I have loved the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. You know, back then they didn't have church. They had temple. They had Ark of the Covenant. They had, you know, not even kind of temple, tabernacle, weird stuff, okay? Not at all this. But what they did have in terms of God's presence and gathering of God's people and fellowship with the saints, if you want to call that, David's into it. David's like, I love this. I love your altar. I go about your altar. I love to sing thanksgivings and tell everybody about your wondrous works. I love the habitation of your house. I like the place where your glory dwells. I want to be where you are, kind of idea. And David he's in the proper frame of spirit to truly enjoy the fellowship in God's community. Right? We read about the inventory that he took of himself in verses 2 through 5. He passed the test. He's walking in integrity, keeping with the truth. And so it only makes sense then that he can enjoy the fullness of the community of God. Whereas, had he been found guilty of some of the things in the list there, can't say that it would have been the same. And I find that true even in the church context so many years later. If a person isn't walking in their integrity, and a person isn't keeping in step with the truth, rather they're living compromised, lukewarm, sinful lives on the outside, the fellowship of the saints and the presence of God and the gathering of God's people becomes less and less precious for them, up to and including the day that they actually leave and never come back. It's sad, but it happens. See, there's a real sense in which we need to maintain our walk, where we need to kind of keep pace. Otherwise, we run the risk of just kind of losing interest in the race, getting distracted with worldly things, falling off the ship because we were sleeping too close to the edge. Fellowship with God's people is never more appreciated than when you are, by the world, most hated. Here's David in a position where he's like, God, I need vindication. Why? Because I'm living a righteous life and everybody thinks I'm suspicious for some reason. I mean, I guess you'd expect that of a sinful world, to hold somebody righteous in suspicion. But David's like, it doesn't make it any less uncomfortable. That's why I love going to where you are, God. Because I don't find fellowship with the world. I am certainly not comfortable out here in this den of wolves or whatever you want to call it. I don't feel safe out here. I don't feel friendly out here. I want to go to where you are and where your people are, where I feel safe. I feel like I actually have something in common with somebody. In verse 8, I'm going to read it again. He says, Lord, I have loved the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. David's love in life is not for the carnal pleasures of the world, but for the sweet presence of God, with which the carnal pleasures of the world often compete and interfere. It's kind of one or the other. Again, some of us, we're trying to have both, because both are somewhat pleasurable. The presence of God, if you've ever had it, if you've ever felt it, it's nice. It's wonderful. And listen, the pleasures of the world, the carnal pleasures of the world, hey, listen, they're nice too, huh? Aren't they? If we're honest, everybody here says yes. You're a liar if you'd say no. We all know it. Even the Bible knows it. Sin is sweet, the Bible says. Did you know that? There's a verse that says, sin is sweet. Of course, it goes on and says, for a season, you know, like it's temporary, but it is for a while. But I'll tell you that they kind of oppose one another. So what do you want in life? Do you want the sweetness of the presence of God, or do you want the pleasure of the carnal allurements of the world? Because I'll tell you, if you want to enjoy the things of the world, it's going to begin to interfere with your desire for closeness with Christ. And I'll tell you that the one who becomes so protective of their closeness with Christ that they go to war against the carnal pleasures of the world, that person will become a dynamic servant of God. It's that person that becomes a... they're hard to stop. Those are the ones that will grow. They will shoot for the stars. These will become the modern day warriors. These are the disciples. These are the apostles, prophets, whatever. You read in the Old Testament, there were some that kind of the cream rises to the top sort of idea. There are some Christians that they're just going to shoot for the moon and leave the rest of us in the dust. Why? Because they cherish the presence of God and they don't tinker around anymore with the carnal enticements of the world. They've just decided, I don't want them. I don't want this. I'm a single track individual. And that's David. No surprise, is it? Right? Because David ends up becoming David. There's a reason. Had he, for his entire lifespan, been continually seduced back into the world, we would only know him of as Dave. You get it? But not this guy. King of Israel, hero of Scripture, a man after God's own heart. David, the warrior, the king. Why? Single track. He loved the presence of God. He says in verse 9, do not gather my soul with sinners, nor my life with bloodthirsty men, in whose hands is a sinister scheme, and whose right hand is full of bribes. Now this psalm, as all psalms do, as do the rest of Scripture, this psalm alludes to Jesus in many ways. And we see it here in verses 9 and 10. It says, do not gather my soul with sinners. In other words, when it says gather my soul, that it's talking about death. David's like, don't let me die with sinners among bloodthirsty men in whose hands is a sinister scheme, demonic, evil, in whose right hand is full of bribes. This alludes to Jesus, totally. Jesus was crucified. He was gathered with sinners. He was crucified alongside of criminals in the presence of bloodthirsty men in whose hands was a sinister scheme, all for a 30-piece of silver bribe. Even as we read Psalm 26, your mind, the mind of the reader, is being conditioned to receive Jesus. All of this meant to wash our minds with the truth of Christ before Christ even shows up. That when he does, we all go, I get it. Everything becomes clear now. Jesus is in the picture, and it all makes sense. In verse 11, David says, but as for me, I will walk in my integrity. Redeem me and be merciful to me. My foot stands in an even place. In the congregations, I will bless the Lord. This psalm ends with resolve. 12 verses, and David's going, I will stand. I mean, if you go back to verse 1, the whole psalm begins with pleading, you know, like, vindicate me, Lord. He's pleading, he's weak. And it ends with determination and resolve. That's oftentimes the example that David sets. As we go through the Psalms, how many times have we seen David begins with just like, oh my Lord, my, you know, this and that, and everything's terrible, and just please help me. And by the end, he's like, I will stand and I will praise you in the presence of the saints and praise the Lord, all you people, right? It's almost like he talks himself out of trouble through prayer. It's the example that David sets. Why? Because it will often be the case with those who are in Christ. He sets the example because it's often going to be the case for you and I. We see this also in Jesus. Of course, the grandest example in all of mankind's history, in all of Scripture, Jesus, the prime example of going from a place of weakness to determined resolve, all within the span of one night. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he's up there in desperation and weakness, praying to God. The Bible says he was even unable to stand, absolutely physically spent before it even got underway. In Matthew chapter 26, it says that he fell down on his face and prayed. Luke tells us that he was sweating blood. It's a physiological condition. He's under extreme stress and anxiety. And yet, only a short while later, several hours after that, we see him with the strength and determination to carry a somewhere between 80 and 110 pound crossbeam, approximately 650 yards, to the place where he would be crucified, after having been beat so severely that the typical victim would have been rendered unconscious, if not dead. So here you have him in full health and full strength, totally weakened and desperate before God that he can't even stand on his own two feet. And then you have him after enduring a Roman flogging that would have left many of his fellow man dead, carrying this immense weight, that distance. What drove him on? In Hebrews it tells us it was joy. For the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross. He starts in the Garden of Gethsemane with what looks to be anything but joy. And by the time he shoulders that cross, he's ready to go. And here in a microcosmic picture, long before Christ ever came, we see David doing the same. He starts as a weak and broken man pleading for vindication, but by the end he's going, I will shoulder my cross and I will move. I will not be stopped. Guys, can you relate? For the Christian, how many times is it going to be that we experience this? Probably many, over and over and over again. God will bring you to a place of weakness. And when you're there, I suggest strongly that you pray, that you get to praying for yourself, and that you pray relentlessly and don't stop until you have a firm resolve to pick up your cross and move regardless of what happens. You get on your face before God and you cry out to him and you say, God, vindicate me. God, help me. God, strengthen me. Do what you can, because I don't know if I can go on. And then by the end, you stand to your feet and you move forward in righteousness and obedience. That's what Christians do. We see it in Scripture from cover to cover. We see it in the greatest of human examples, and we see it in Christ. The Bible tells us to pray unceasingly. There's all kinds of things to pray for. There's all kinds of, I mean, everything needs prayer and everybody needs prayer. Don't forget to pray for yourself. Father God, we come to you this evening and we ask that we would allow Psalm 26 to speak to our prayer life. That when the world is against us, through prayer and supplication, we come to a place of determined resolve that the world won't stop us. Weakness never stopped a Christian. Ineptitude, inadequacy, shortcoming, failure, none of that ever stopped a Christian. I pray, Father, that we don't put our faith in prayer, but the one through whom prayer connects us. That we see in you, Jesus, the example and the power and the inspiration and the motivation and the theology, the teaching, the knowledge and the understanding that will in the end be all we need to remain faithful for the rest of our days. In spite of weaknesses, Father, thank you for such a promise. Thank you for such an example. Thank you for such chapters as this that remind us that nothing is able to stop an individual who puts their faith in Jesus. Not even the gates of hell. May we remember this beautiful truth in our darkest hour. That when we are brought to our knees, we pour ourselves out to you, only to gather it up once again and stand in greater strength than ever before. And may we do so with joy. We praise your name for all of the wonderful things that you've done for us and the beautiful life you've begun in us. We pray that it will continue and that we finish well. May we shoulder our cross and follow Jesus to the very end. Amen.